Good afternoon. My name is Josh. I am a lecturer in plastic surgery, and I'm presenting some of the work that we've been doing looking at diagnosis of infection, not by seeing patients in person. So we've got a perfect melting pot of circumstance at the minute. We do lots of operations in the UK across lots of specialties, and the patients that we operate on are getting sicker, older, they are multi-morbid. And up to 40% of those patients will develop an infection after their operation. It changes depending on what operation they've had, what specialty is operated on them, but that's the highest number. And we know that infection is particularly bad. They stay in hospital for longer, they have antibiotics. In some cases, they lose limbs. In some cases, they'll pass away. And we also know that treating infections earlier has better outcomes for patients. At the same time, we, in a lot of specialties, operate a hub and spoke model where patients come to hubs for their complex operation, and then they are discharged long distances away from that hospital to convalesce at home. That means that in patients that are well, they've got a large burden of follow-up if we ask them to come and see us. And conversely, patients who are unwell might not be able to come to hospital and rely heavily on primary and community care for their aftercare. On top of all of that, we are very bad in the UK at looking for infection proactively. And then there was this thing called a pandemic, and it changed the way that we practice our healthcare almost overnight. There was more virtual online consultations, and we started to think, well, can we use this, the changes that have been made, to change the way that we do post-operative care, and can we diagnose infection as a result of that? In summary, can we take pictures like the guy on the left, as you look at the screen, and direct care towards patients like that, and at the same time take patients like the patient on the right and say, actually, you're doing pretty well. You don't need to travel 60 miles to come for your follow-up. You can stay where you are. So the first thing that we did or have done is a systematic review. We've done it according to guidelines. We prospectively registered it, and we've looked for studies that investigate infection and telemedicine. We screened and we've done a methodological assessment using a recognized methodological assessment tool, and we undertook a meta-analysis as a result of that. For the purposes of the review, the target condition was surgical site infection with a clear definition, which we'll come back to. The index test was follow-up either by telephone, video call, photograph, or an online questionnaire, or some combination of those. And the reference standard was an in-person review by a clinician with diagnosis according to that criteria. This is the study flowchart, which unfortunately hasn't presented very well, but basically after deduplication, we had 1,400 records that we distilled down to 17 included in a meta-analysis. And those 17 studies had a high risk of bias in at least one domain in every single study, some more than others, but there was no study that was at a low risk of bias across the board. Studies took place in 9 countries, 5 continents, and a mix of lower and higher to middle economically developed countries. And there were 11,500 observations made in 20,000 patients. And the reason that there's a disparity is because a lot of this was done as a subset analysis of larger studies. The average age of participants in these studies was 47 plus or minus 13, and the majority of participants were female. The overall infection rate across all studies was about 5.5%, which is in line with the literature. And what we've got here is a forest plot of sensitivity and specificity. And the important figure is that the mean sensitivity of using any telemedicine was 87.9%, and the mean specificity was 96.8%. In short, if you took 1,000 patients that had had an operation and conducted all of their follow-up online, 910 patients who didn't have an infection, you would correctly say they don't have an infection. And 83 patients who did, who you identified as having an infection virtually, 53 of those would actually have an infection. So there'd be about 30 that you would call back unnecessarily. This is a receiver operator characteristic curve. Basically, a perfect curve would be an L-shaped curve in the top left corner, and a completely random test would be a diagonal line from the bottom left to the top right. So what you can see is that this is actually pretty good. This is bordering a very, very good test. We did a subgroup analysis where we said, well, okay, if this is how we're following them up, if we take a photo, surely that must be better. Well, actually, it's not. It makes it worse. The specificity drops slightly to 92.6%, but the sensitivity drops quite a way to 63.9%. So whenever you do a study, you have to ask, what's the point? What are the benefits to this? Ultimately, remote identification of infection can be highly specific and can be very sensitive. And though it might seem sensible, actually, from the evidence that we've got, taking a photograph of a wound and sending it to a clinician might not improve that diagnostic accuracy. Remote consultations, as they are used in these studies, may provide a safe way of reducing the travel burden to patients and driving down carbon emissions. So at the minute, 10% of emissions by the NHS in England is due to travel. And that's travel of patients to outpatient appointments. There's something like 76 kilos of carbon dioxide equivalent attributed to a single outpatient appointment. And there's an element of inevitability about this. Because of what has happened over the last 2 years, everyone is doing this. Everyone has moved things online. And actually, the research base behind it hasn't really caught up yet. No one is looking and saying, well, yes, everyone is doing this, but should we be? And on top of, like I said, the surveillance for infection in this country is very poor. So in 2019 to 2020, 125,000 operations were added into the Public Health England surveillance database. That's in comparison to the 8 million operations that were undertaken. And of those 125,000, 100,000 were in orthopaedics, which has mandatory surveillance. But the mandatory surveillance in orthopaedics is one quarter of your yearly data, and you can choose as an organisation which quarter you provide. It's very bad. However, not without its limitations. So the average age was much younger. The demographic of participants isn't representative. And you have to have access to the internet, to a phone, to a smartphone, something which means that you can engage with this. And the populations at most risk of not being able to come back for follow-up are also at a very high risk of not having access to this technology. Older populations in particular being at risk being left behind through either digital naivety or lack of digital confidence. And the existing evidence that's out there, as we showed, was at high risk of bias and methodologically isn't very sound in a lot of cases. On top of all of that, the definition of infection isn't very good. We are bad at defining infection. The CDC criteria that we use has a lot of parameters, and then at the very bottom says, oh, and by the way, if a doctor says they've got an infection, they've got an infection. So thank you very much. I'm happy to answer any questions. And if anyone's interested, you can scan that, and there's about 4 or 5 different ways of contacting me. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Have we got any questions down at the front?
So obviously it's quite interesting that the sensitivity dropped so much when they showed you a photograph. Is that because maybe people weren't taking histories if they had a photo and maybe talking to the patients better? Or
no, don't think so. So one of the studies in this was a study that I did as part of my doctorate thesis. There is a problem with lack of standardization of photographs. So a lack of white balance, a lack of proper imagery. You ask someone to take a picture of their surgical wound. If it's on their hand, great stuff. They'll have no problem. If it's on their belly or in their groin, more difficult. Things like erythema, which is a really critical clinical sign of infection, doesn't always come across well in a photograph, which is one of the things that was driving it down. In addition, all of the studies that it was studied in are subsets of a bigger study. So they're not, this is an A versus B comparison, and this is the entire reason for doing the study.
Was there any variation in the sensitivity and specificity by site of surgical operation? Because I think, and what specialty would this most be beneficial for? Just thinking, if I had my groin operated on, I might not want to show that over a webcam.
Yeah, absolutely. No, that's completely understandable. So what wasn't in there was the breakdown of specialty. So we didn't look at it by site of operation. We looked at it by breakdown of specialty. There was a lot of general, a lot of obs and gyne, so C-section wounds. There were 2 studies in vascular and a couple where they weren't very clear about what they'd included. So from that point of view, there was a decent spread. And in the full data, there is a subgroup analysis of by specialty. as part of the work that I've done previously, I've actually sat down with some patients and said, would you be willing to do this? Do you think you could manage? And unanimously, the answer was, yeah, we could. If I can't do it, I get someone else to do it. And I asked them specifically, would you mind if it was your groin that you're sending us a picture of? And I got answers like, doesn't really matter. It's going to a doctor. They look at it all the time. You could put it on the internet, and as long as it doesn't show me face, who would know that it was my groin? So actually, although on the face of it, it feels like, oh, patients might feel a bit funny about it, as long as you're explicit in what you're explaining to them, and again, it comes back to a proper informed consent, patients don't seem to have a problem with it.
Yes.
Okay, I think this one you've just touched on, but maybe you can expand on this. It seems to me the role of family is going to be really important for older patients, because I can bet you that most sons and daughters would rather not have to transport someone to hospital. They'll be happy to go in with their smartphone and facilitate a call or whatever. So if you're going to do more research on this, can you think about the role of family, and maybe for those who live alone, the role of social carers who are going in to do the care packages? Because it seems to me that this would be so helpful for so many people.
Yeah, absolutely. And one of the things that we are developing is a research study looking at not whether this is effective, but how we increase engagement with this. How do we look at those marginalised populations and say, how do we get them to use an application, use their smartphone, and engage with it? What we've identified is there is a heavy reliance on family for bringing patients back into hospital. And particularly in Hull, where we've done most of this research, the region is massive. And equally, for those patients who don't have family to rely on, they are 3 or 4 buses away. And I take your point, getting that engagement rather than asking them to drive them to an appointment to facilitate an online appointment is vital.
And Hull did well with the Sustainable Development Goals. So I was very pleased to hear you mention the carbon load. And I just think that's a really interesting thing for us to be thinking about in research going forward. So well done, including at least something about the carbon value of the transport.
If anyone is interested, there is an NIHR Green Call coming up. So across all funding streams, there's an eco angle to the next call, which this may or may not be going
Brilliant.
Into, fingers crossed.
Two last quick questions, then we're going to have to move on.
Hello, hi. My name's Catherine. I'm a doctoral fellow and I'm a peds reg. So I was just wondering if you've got any insight into how this would work in paediatric populations whilst doing your research?
So we've not looked at paediatrics. Most of these studies are in adults. Purely from a research ethics point of view, it's much harder to look at this in children. However, there is a large body of work going on separately where they've looked at wound dressings post-operatively. So looking at dressing versus glue versus no dressing at all. And some of their follow-up has been done online. So we haven't, but there is work ongoing that might answer some of those questions.
And last question.
Hi, I'm Steph, one of the palliative ACFs. My thought was whether there's space to sort of integrate this into an algorithm to identify those that, if this definitely wouldn't work for them, is that still acceptable if you're targeting a large proportion to try and reduce those emissions, reduce the need for those patients to come in and use this in the majority of patients and accept a group that will still need to come in?
Absolutely. Is the answer to the question? Absolutely, yes. The work that needs to happen before is how we maximize the engagement to maximize the impact of it. Once that has been done, we can then look and say, okay, we've got a set of criteria that we think these are the patients that can safely have follow-up in this regard, and this is the potential benefit of that. If you fall out of those criteria, we shouldn't be saying, no, absolutely, we're not going to do your follow-up unless you do it like this. There should then be a provision for those patients to come back to hospital. But what it will mean is that if you or I was to have an operation tomorrow, if you had have your appendix out, you could go back home. You wouldn't need to come into hospital. You wouldn't need to visit your GP for your wound check in a week. And all of that can be done using an app on your phone, if you are comfortable and can safely do that.
Thank you very much. Thanks, Josh.
No problem. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay.